Good morning and welcome to Grace Baptist Church. We're so glad you've chosen to worship with us this morning. We just want to take a few minutes to let you know about some things going on in the church. This Thursday is our men's lunch at Dameron's. Join us for lunch and fellowship at 12 o'clock. Our fall festival is coming up quickly. It's on October 28th. We will be having entertainment, a costume contest, trunk or treat, inflatables, food, and more. We need your help and we need your involvement. If you're interested in serving or decorating a car, this is a perfect chance for you to get involved. So join us for our fall festival on October 28th. We are so glad you chose to worship with us this morning. Whether you're visiting us for the first time or you've been here your entire life, we are so excited you're here. We hope you have an amazing morning here at Grace Baptist Church.
Hey, good morning, guys. Man, we're so excited that you are here this morning. And I hope you guys are excited to be here. If you are a guest with us here this morning for the first time, again, we're honored that you're here. Right in the service, if you kind of walk out this door, take immediate right. Our pastor and the deacon of the week just want to shake your hand, get to know you a little bit. But man, we're excited that you have come to worship. Hopefully you walked in the doors with the attitude of worship here this morning, and that's what you're here to do. Let me pray for us, and we'll get started. God, I thank you for this morning. Thank you for each person who is here. We're not here by accident, that God, you brought us here for a purpose. So God, whatever that purpose is, I pray that our hearts, our minds, our souls are open to listen to hear what you have to say to us. So God, speak to us here this morning. Fall on this place afresh and anew today. God, I pray that we walk out these doors differently than we came in them, because we know we've been in the presence of God here this morning. So again, speak to us in only the way that you can. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, good morning, guys. Again, if you would, just take a few moments. Stand, shake a few hands, high five a few people, hug a few necks, whatever it is you decide you want to do. All right?
Guys, it's great to be with you this morning. We're so glad you've chosen to worship with us this morning. We serve a mighty, awesome, redeeming Lord. We're here to give him praise, honor, glory this morning. Let's lift him up. Let's sing his praise. Let's come before his throne. Who breaks the power? Sing it out.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty? So much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings.
This is amazing.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross.
Of our praise, adoration, everything that we could ever bring. There's no way we could ever repay the price he paid for us, but we can lift up his name this morning. We can shout of his goodness. Let's sing this out.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
So if you've looked at the worship guide this morning, things are going to look a little different on the set list. This morning we lost around half of our band, so we are going to run with this morning and make it work. So here's the thing, since some of our band couldn't make it this morning, that means I need twice the energy, twice the singing, and twice the engagement from you guys. You see, there's this crazy concept that I believe that the amount that we put into worship determines what we get out. So when we come before God with no expectations, he's not going to move. But when we come before God saying, you know what? I am in the presence of a mighty redeeming Savior. I have brought his presence with me because I am a redeemed child of God, and I know he is going to do great things this morning. Then God will move. So this morning, can we just come before his presence saying, God, I know you're gonna move, and I know you're gonna meet with us this morning through music, through your word. Let's approach his throne this morning in complete surrender, complete honor, complete adoration. This is a throwback. I know you know it. Let's sing it.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great, and how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will sing how great.
morning, age to age, and age to age, he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead, the Godhead, three in one. He's the Father, Spirit, Son, Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will sing, how great, how great is our God. Again, how great,
how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
Hear the name above every other name.
What could separate us now? name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus.
You are worthy. You are holy. You are worthy. Worthy God you are. Cause death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory.
What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
He is worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of every breath of praise that we could ever bring before Him. He's worthy. God, we're so thankful, we're so grateful for the price that You paid by sending Your Son to die on the cross. That's why we sing, that's why we worship this morning. We love You, God, so meet with us right where we are. Sing this out, worthy. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for You, oh Jesus. We live for You. You're the name above it all. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for You, oh Jesus. We live for You. Sing holy and holy. There is no one like You. There is none beside You. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who You are and fill me with Your heart and lead me in Your love to those around the earth. Worthy of every song could ever sing. You're worthy. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring.
Of every breath.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for You, oh Jesus. We live for You.
The name above it all.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for You, oh, we live for You.
Sing holy and holy.
There is no one like You. There is none beside You.
Put my trust in You alone.
is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Let's sing that out one more time. Proclaiming, God, there's no one like you. Nothing compares to your warm embrace. The grace that you've shown us, the freedom you've given us to live in. Sing holy and holy.
There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
God, we thank you for all you've done. We're so thankful for all the blessings you've given us, God. We're so thankful for the fact that we get to come here this morning and worship a risen, redeeming Savior who sent his Son to leave perfection in heaven to save us lost, broken sinners. So God, we take nothing for granted, not one minute in your house for granted. God, speak through your word this morning. Touch lives, transform hearts, God. Break off chains that are binding. God, give fresh starts to lives that are broken, to fires that are burned out. God, we love you, we thank you, we praise you. In your beautiful name we pray, amen. You guys can be seated.
There you go. All right. So thank you, Noah and Praise Team, for leading our worship today in Michael's absence. And it's tough when you got instrumentalists that aren't here. So thank you, Noah, for jumping over there on the piano. And thank you, Chris, Rob, for taking and doing whatever you could and can to do for the Lord in the way of instruments today. Thank you so much for worshiping the Lord together this morning. A man was flying from Seattle to San Francisco, and the plane had to make an unexpected stop in Sacramento along the way. Some kind of mechanical problem there. And so the flight attendant explained that there would be a delay, and she told all of the passengers they could get off for about 50 minutes while they checked on the mechanical problem of the airplane. Everybody got off when they landed except one man who was blind. He was still sitting there in his seat with his seeing eye dog beside him. And apparently this man had flown the airlines before because all the crew knew him by name. The pilot, the co-pilot, the stewardess, they all knew him by name. And so the pilot comes out of the cockpit and he says, "Bill, we're going to be here in Sacramento for about an hour. Would you not like to get off and stretch your legs?" And the blind man replied, "No thanks, but my dog needs to take a walk." So picture this, okay? All the people are on the runway and they're outside the plane, and they look up and they see coming down the steps the pilot who is wearing sunglasses with a seeing eye dog. Everybody immediately wanted to change planes. There is much adage to that old saying, some people make things happen, others watch things happen, while still others are left wondering what happened. In the first century, some Christians were making things happen. Others were watching things happen while the world was wondering what happened. The gospel was gradually moving out from Jerusalem. You remember the Lord's command there in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. You can recall what he says there. He said there that you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. In the first seven chapters, the gospel is being shared in Jerusalem. In chapters 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12, it is being shared in Judea and Samaria. And now, from chapter 13 to the end of the book of Acts, the church is going to be sharing the message to all the ends of the earth. The activity of missions is what we're going to talk about today. The activity of missions is about to be launched. Every church that wants to be a great church, every church that wants to be an obedient church, every church that wants to be a growing church has got to be involved in missions. Can I get an amen? Amen. If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn with me this morning to Acts chapter 13. Acts chapter 13, and would you be so kind to stand for the reading of God's Word? Acts chapter 13, the first four verses. Now in the church that was at Antioch, there were certain prophets and teachers: Barnabas, Simeon who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Spirit said, "Now separate to me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." Then having fasted and prayed and laid hands on them, they sent them away. So being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia, and from there they sailed to Cyprus. God bless the reading of your word. Now the application of your word. Be with me as I explain it so that the people can easily apply what the Spirit wants to say to us today. And God's people agree with me by saying amen. Thank you. You may be seated. William Bennett records the greatest words ever spoken by one of America's greatest patriots, Nathan Hale. Just before Nathan Hale was executed on September the 22nd, 1776, by the British, his last recorded words were these: "I only regret that I have but one life to give for my country." These early believers had the same devotion. Dear hearts, you and I have a tremendous responsibility to share the gospel, and let me remind you this morning, we have but one life to carry out that mission. Some Christians say, "Well, you know, preacher, there's a lot of work to be done right here in our own city." And I agree. There is a lot of work to be done in Tullahoma. Tullahoma is fast becoming more lost than it is saved. Some others would say, "Well, preacher, there are so many lost people overseas that have never heard the gospel. Those unreached people groups, don't we need to go over there and share the gospel?" And I would agree, yes. So which is it? Is it home missions or foreign missions? It's not either or, it's both. We are to share the gospel to the ends of the earth, but we are to start with our neighbors right here in our own city. Don't go halfway across the world to share the gospel to an unreached people group if you're not willing to cross the street and share it with your neighbor. And so today we're going to look at the gospel and this idea of missions. Mission starts with the church of God. Not the one on Vine Street here in Tullahoma. The one I'm referring to is the church at Antioch. Now, I want you to remember that the church at Antioch was the daughter of the church at Jerusalem. Just like Grace is the daughter of Highland Baptist here in Tullahoma, Antioch was the daughter of the mother church, the church at Jerusalem there. Jerusalem for many years was the control center for the gospel, but now it seems that the shift has moved to the church at Antioch. Why is that? The reason for this is that the church at Jerusalem became very narrow in its outlook. The church at Jerusalem became very inwardly focused. They started thinking it was all about them. They lost their missionary fervor. They lost their missionary zeal. They lost their passion for evangelism. And when it did, God passed the torch to Antioch. That can still happen today, folks. God can come into a church and write Ichabod over the door. The glory of the Lord has departed. And so the church, the torch was passed from the church at Jerusalem to the church at Antioch. And folks, let me say that the greatest churches, the churches that are winning souls to Christ, the churches that are growing, are those churches with a missionary zeal, an outward focus. When we turn inward and start thinking it's all about us, then we've lost it. So the church in Antioch had the torch, and they were sharing the gospel. You see, here at Grace, we have two choices. We can sit in our seats and we can gripe about what we like and what we don't like and what we do like, and we can drop and we can blow away. Or we can get our minds off ourselves and what we like and don't like and get it on the lost people out there, and God will add into our church every day. That's the kind of church at Antioch was. God blessed them. He used the church in Antioch for a number of years. But then they started to think about themselves too much. They started to focus inwardly. And God moved on. He passed the torch to the church at Ephesus. After a period of time, Ephesus, God was using it with tremendous power. But then you remember what happened to the church at Ephesus? They lost their first love. Revelation tells us they lost their first love. That means they fell out of love with Jesus. And when they quit loving Jesus, they quit loving people. And God's Spirit moved on. And then the base of operation moved from Ephesus to Constantinople. And for a period of time, Constantinople was the base of operation. But then Constantinople became dry and dead and filled with formalism. And when it did, God moved on. And from there, he moved to Rome, and Rome became the center of activity. But then Rome became plagued with church tradition, and they started to focus on themselves. They lost their passion and their missionary fervor, and God moved on. And from there, God moved to the churches in Germany, and Germany became the center of activity for missions. But after a while, they began to approach the Bible like the study of any other book, and German skepticism and rationalism began to eat away at the spiritual vim and vigor of the church. And when that happened, God moved on. And God moved to the churches in England, and England became the center of activity, the center of missions. But when England became dead and spiritually apathetic, when that happened, God moved on. And then America came on the scene, and for a number of years, America has been the center of evangelistic fervor and soul-winning activity. For centuries, America has been sending missionaries out by the scores to other countries. But now, worldliness and secularism and apathy and complacency have crept into our churches. And that is why today we have more than 80% of our churches that are declined or dying. I can't help but wonder, is God getting ready to move on? Is God getting ready to take his hand off of America? Is God about to pass the torch to another continent? Is God about to give evangelism, the center of evangelism, to a third world country? I want you to understand, brothers and sisters, God is not obligated to remain with any nation or country unless that nation or country stays true to him, the scriptures, and the mission to which he gives it. I don't think you heard me, church. I don't think you heard me. I'm going to have to repeat it all day long till you're sitting here till 4 o'clock. I don't think that the Lord is obligated to any church that turns their back on him. Now, I know some of you say, but we're America. I don't care if we're America. If we turn our back on God and we turn our back on Israel, God is not obligated to bless us anymore. So this morning, we're going to see what made the church in Antioch so special. First of all, we're going to look at the ministers. Verse 1 talks about some prophets and teachers. Now, I want you to understand there's a difference between prophets and teachers. Prophets are people like preachers and evangelists. They go out preaching the gospel. They preach either in a local pulpit or they go out and they preach in tent revivals. They preach on the road. They preach in auditoriums. They preach in the open. They preach on the streets. They are preaching the word of God out there everywhere. Teachers are those who stay in the church and instruct and disciple those who get saved, right? Now, you'll notice that verse 1 mentions five men. Look at it with me. This list of prophets and teachers is symbolic of the universal appeal of the gospel. These men were from different parts of the world with different upbringings, different occupations, different backgrounds. And Barnabas, first of all, was a Jew from Cyprus. You know Barnabas. Barnabas was Mr. Encourager. He was the son of encouragement. You felt better about being around Barnabas because he was always building you up. He was always affirming you. He was always making you just feel good about yourself. That's why his spiritual gift was encouragement. We like to be around people with the gift of encouragement. Amen? And then there was Simeon. Simeon was a Jew who was nicknamed Niger, which translates black man. He was an African. His spiritual gift was mercy. Some have suggested that he was Simon of Cyrene, the one who carried Jesus' cross, but there is no proof for that. But that would be pretty neat if he was. Then there was Lucius from Cyrene. Lucius was a charter member of the church at Antioch. Lucius's gift was administration. He's probably the fellow worker that Paul mentioned in Romans chapter 16, verse 21. So Lucius. And then there is Manan. Manan, the Bible says, was brought up with Herod the Tetrarch. He was either a close friend or an adopted brother of King Herod Antipas. King Herod Antipas, if you will remember, is the one who had John the Baptist beheaded. And so it is hard to imagine that two boys growing up in the same household, one of them, Manan, becomes a minister. The other one, Herod, becomes a murderer. Manan's gift was service. He was always there ready to serve. We love people like that too, don't we? And then, of course, there was Saul of Tarsus, the trained Jewish rabbi, the greatest man to walk the face of the earth other than Jesus Christ himself. And Paul's spiritual gift was teaching. This little band of men exemplified the influence of Christianity and how God can unify people and get people on the same page. People from different backgrounds, people from different occupations, people from all over the world, and get them all on the same page. What's the secret of togetherness? The secret of togetherness is Jesus Christ. When we fall in love with Jesus Christ, we're on the same page. Amen? And then notice the ministry. Verse 2 says that they minister to the Lord. These five men minister to the Lord. And when they say they minister to the Lord, that means they preached and taught the Word of God. I've heard people say, well, Pastor Tim ministered the Word to us this morning. That means I preached the Word to you, right? I shared the word of God with you. I broke the bread of life with you. That's what it means when it says they ministered to the Lord. And it says when they preached the word, when they ministered to the Lord, they fasted. Now, fasting is something we don't hear a whole lot about anymore. Fasting is the discipline of doing without food for a period of time in order to engage in some kind of spiritual discipline. Fasting shows that we're seeking God's will, that we're seeking God's power. Fasting is not for show. If you are on a fast, you don't go around bragging about it. Jesus said, when you fast, don't be sad-faced like the hypocrites, for they make their faces unattractive so that their fasting is obvious to people. When you fast, you don't go around saying, hey, everybody, I'm super spiritual, I'm on a fast. You don't let anybody know. When my dad went through fast, we knew because we lived in the household. But he didn't go out and brag and tell everybody that he was on a fast. Fasting is when you're giving up food so that you can seek God's will and ask for God's part and ask for God's power. Some of you mothers know what it's like to be so concerned about a sick child that you couldn't eat. Well, dear brothers and sisters, don't you think we ought to be so worried about the spiritual condition of others and so concerned about finding God's will and having God's power in our life that sometimes you and I ought to not go without food? Ought to go without food, amen? There ought to be times when we fast.
We ought to be times where we follow that spiritual discipline. So they preached, they fasted, they prayed. That was a picture of the church at Antioch at worship. And when these spiritual commodities are present, that's when God breaks through. God shows up and God shows out. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of having services as usual. What I want to see is unusual services. Can I get a witness? Something powerful happens in a church where the word of God is preached and people are fasting and praying. So we see the ministry, then we see the mission. Now, what is the mission of the church? Is it education? No. Is it social reform? No. Is it fellowship? No. What is the mission of the church? It is evangelism and mission. The mission of the church is right here. Say it with me, folks. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. That is the mission of the church. Now, I want to clarify something. When God saves us, He calls all of us into the ministry. He calls all of us into the ministry. But then God specifically calls some people into the ministry vocationally. Okay? This business of serving Jesus is not a profession. It just makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up when I hear these young guys today. And we've had some of them around here. I've had some of them in school that say, I think I'm going to choose the ministry because it's a good profession. I had a guy that told me, he said, you got a cushy job. I'd like to have your cushy job. Let me tell you something. The ministry is not a profession. It is a divine calling. God calls men to preach. When I was 16 years old, God called me to preach. I said, no. He said, oh. I did not seek God in this. I did not choose this. God chose me. When I was 16 years old, God said, I want you to preach. And I argued with God. I fought with God. My dad and my granddad were Baptist preachers. I saw what the ministry did to them. I saw how people treated them. I didn't want to do this. I lived in a Baptist preacher's home. I wanted to be a Christian comedian. I wanted to be a sports broadcaster. I didn't want to be a preacher. I remember one time we're standing around the playground. You know how boys do. We like to brag, and these other two friends of mine started talking. One of them said, my dad is the wealthiest guy in Lewisburg. I said, oh, really? He said, yeah, he owns 5 businesses. Well, you know how boys like to outdo each other. The second boy said, my dad's the wealthiest guy in Lewisburg. He has a 250-acre farm. Well, I spoke up and said, my dad's the wealthiest guy in Lewisburg. They said, really? I said, yeah, he owns hell. And I said, what? They said, what? I said, yeah, I heard him tell my mom the deacons gave it to him last night. I didn't want to be a preacher. There are many days that I still don't want to be a preacher. But I tell you what, the God's call is up on my life. I can't run from it. I can't hide from it. I'll be miserable if I walk away from it. And this is what I got to do. So God called me to preach, just like He called Barnabas and Saul to preach. And He said to Barnabas and Saul, separate them to me for the work to which I have called them. Now, folks, I want you to know that we, even though I'm the preacher, we're all in this together. That sounds like something from High School Musical, doesn't it? We're all in this together. I lead the church and I stand up here and preach, but your responsibility is to pray for me and support me and help me get the gospel out to the world. What good would it be for me to stand up here and preach my guts out to a bunch of empty chairs? I mean, we've already got one 8:30 service, amen? I need you to invite your family and your friends to come hear the blessed gospel. What good is it for us to have a trunk or treat and have a Christian entertainer from North Carolina to come and share the gospel if nobody volunteers to decorate their cars and hand out candy? We're all in this together. And here's what I want you to see. God calls Simeon and Lucius and Manaen to be occupational ministers just like He calls you. But He calls some, Saul and Barnabas, to be vocational ministers like me. It is God's job to do the calling and the church's job to do the confirming. When a man, when God calls a man to preach or to be a missionary or to be a deacon, the church has a responsibility to confirm that. How do we do that? The same way they did it. Look at verse 3. They laid their hands on them and sent them away. If you don't connect the dots there, that's where we get our idea of present-day ordination services. Ordination does not give a man authority to preach or to be a deacon. That authority comes from God if he's truly called. But ordination is the affirmation of the church. You see, brothers and sisters, when a man is called to be a deacon or a missionary or a pastor, the other ordained men of the church come and they lay their hands on him and they pray over him, and they're praying for God to give him his power and to give his anointing and to give this man spiritual discernment and faith and all the other necessary gifts that he's going to need to do that which God has called him to do. When God calls a missionary overseas, that missionary doesn't go overseas just to represent himself. He's over there representing the church that loves him and prays for him and supports him as well. Friend, you may never cross the ocean, but you can send others. With your financial support, you can keep the missionary work going all around the world. One of these days when you get to heaven, a man or a woman or a boy or a girl is going to come up to you and say, I want to thank you because I'm in heaven because of you. And you're going to look at them and you're going to say, I've never seen you before in my life. And they're going to say, no, but you gave your money and you prayed and a missionary came and shared the gospel of Jesus Christ with me and I was saved. So Barnabas and Saul were set apart. The church prayed over them. They laid hands on them. They affirmed them. And verse 4 said they were sent out by the Holy Spirit. Barnabas and Saul had no idea that the impact of their ministry was about to make. Churches were going to be planted all around the world. Millions of lives were going to be affected around the world by the gospel. The world was soon to be different because of their direct and indirect influence of these two missionaries. Brothers and sisters, listen to me. If you and I will get excited about evangelism and we'll get involved in missions both locally and internationally, God will bless us and men and women and boys and girls will get saved. If you believe that, say amen. One of these days we're going to get to hear a thank you in heaven. One of these days we're going to get to go to heaven and we're going to hear someone say, I accepted Jesus Christ because of you, either because of your personal witness or because you prayed for or paid for a missionary. That is what missions is all about. It's the same story on the foreign mission field as it is on the home mission field. It's the story of Jesus Christ. It's telling people about the Lord Jesus Christ and helping them get saved. That's what missions is all about. And if we want to be an obedient church, a growing church, a church that gets its mind off itself and its mind on the world, we've got to be missions minded. God, be with us now as we move into this invitation. God, forgive us for our apathy and our complacency. God, help us to get our minds on those who are not yet recipients of the glorious gospel. Help us to be willing to do whatever it takes. Help us to be involved in this ministry of getting the gospel out to all the world. May we go overseas and may we go across the street. May we do home missions and may we do foreign missions. May we pray and may we pay. May we do whatever it takes. We're all in this together, Lord. We're all ambassadors for you. We're all on the mission field. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand.
The cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. Sorrow may come in the darkest night, but the cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. with the cross as the final word. The cross as the final word. The cross as the final word. The Savior has come with the morning light, but the cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. He traded death for eternal life. The cross has the final word. There's nothing stronger, nothing higher, nothing greater than the name of Jesus. All the honor, all the power, and all the glory to the name of Jesus. There's nothing stronger, nothing higher, nothing greater than the name of Jesus. All the honor, all the power, and all the glory to the name of Jesus. The cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. And he traded death for eternal life, but the cross has the final word.
Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity we have to be in your house of worship. Father, we thank you for the fellowship that we share with this people, Lord. And Father, we pray that you continue to bless, not only in number, but also in our spiritual fervor for you. Father, we just thank you now for those that give, those who cannot give, Lord. We just pray that you would take the tithe and the offering and use them for the strengthening and upbuilding of your kingdom's work. In Christ's name, amen. See me, you know me.
find that I sing that with us.
And I find that I'm safe and warm in your loving arms. I find that I'm safe and warm in your loving arms. You see me, you know me, you love me through and through. You see me, you know me, you love me through and through.
I find,
and I find that I'm safe and warm.